Hello, I'm Saurabh Vishwanath. I'm a first year student studying BCom honors at Jain University.
Hello, I'm Rahul Podar. I'm a first year BMS LS, leadership and strategy student at Jain University.
My name is Krishan Okol. I'm a second year BCom professional student at Jain University.
Hi, I'm Niket Shamagrawal. I study BCom honors. I'm third year in Jain University.
Hi, I'm Pawan Thanani, studying my BMS second year in international business at Jain University.
Now the budget that was given out, the interim budget, the finance minister addressed all key constituencies. These constituencies being the middle class, the soldiers, the HNIs and the other segments of the society. But what was interesting in this budget is that in a move aimed at the middle class, which was perceived as a pro-people budget, this particular one, the interim finance minister Piyush Goyal announced that the individual taxpayers have having an annual income to up to 5 lakh would get a full tax rebate. Interestingly, also individuals with a gross income to up to 6.5 lakh won't need to pay any tax if they invested in provident funds or other prescribed equities. Now, the defense budget has also been enhanced beyond 3 lakh crore, and this is a win for the defense segment of the population of India. And interestingly, the Piyush Goyal, interim finance minister, has also mentioned that the one rank, one pension has been implemented by the, which was implemented by the Modi government, is going to have changes in this particular interim budget, which is better for the people. And the 35,000 crore that have been disbursed for the soldiers in this particular segment is something that will not only appease the people but also help our soldiers, the defense segment of our society, alleviate themselves as both economically and give them a better stability. The gratuity payment has been increased from a limit of 10 lakh to 30 lakh right now. And Piyush Goyal also announced that the income tax returns would now be processed within 24 hours and refunds which would be paid immediately. In the next 2 years, all assessment and verification by the IT, as far as the IT returns are concerned, would be done electronically without intervention by officials. This shows us that there is a streamline in the process of how it is done, and it's better not only for the people of the country but also for the regulatory authorities. And by all analysis, I think the 2019 interim budget was one that was also inertly aimed at the general elections which are due in a couple of months. And I feel that it's a pro-people budget when I mentioned how this is going to help the people. And interestingly, we also have to look at how this is going to help the youngsters this year.
As my friend already mentioned, this budget was aimed at the elections a bit, and it was fairly gifting. It gave a lot to people, especially the middle class, and did not take much away that's already given to them. So this mostly gave benefits to middle class in terms of tax rebates, and also to farmers in terms of 6,000 per annum given to about 120 million farmers who own a fixed quota of land. And all of this, when you sum up, comes up to around a lakh crores of in expenditure, which is less than 0.5% of our GDP. So it's not a very, very costly gift to give. It was expected because it's a budget that's just before the elections. So it was an expected amount. It wasn't too much. But yeah, the main driving force of this year's budget was the election, and also how the mood has been around the country recently about the BJP government, and how the recent elections have affected their power. So this one was a move by the government to win that support back and win the public back.
Also, the rupees 3,000 would be given to the people in the organized sector, unorganized sector, up to 60 years of age, after 60 years of age. So basically, this is also beneficial for them. The people in the unorganized sector who are above 60 years of age would get rupees 3,000 as benefits. Now also, to some extent, I think the benefits are given to the people now because government is earning money from GST, and basically the people impact has been given to the people basically by reducing income tax slab.
Adding on to what my friend said, the budget also specifies the TDS limit now for post office deposits have increased from 10,000 to 40,000. That's a very big boon for the housewives especially, and old age people, because they generally invest in all these securities, fixed deposits I mean, and they for TDS increasing to 40,000, it's better for them. They don't have to file any returns.
Okay, adding on to all this, the government speculates that India could grow to a $5 trillion economy in the next 5 years, taking all these points into consideration, and even so much as to go to a $10 trillion valuation after a period of 8 years.
That being said, the key takeaways additionally from the budget are also the fact that now farmers in our country are being given an annual payout of 6,000 rupees for up to 2 hectares of land in their possession. Additionally, tax deducted at source for rented accommodation for up to 2.4 lakh per year, which comes up to around 12,000 rupees per month, which is a fairly decent value given to the middle class of this country, considering the real estate value and what are the prevailing prices right now, has been also given as a rebate to the people. Additionally, it's important to note that these leeways and these subsidies that are given to people not only help them reinvigorate their economic opportunities, but also helps them explore additional opportunities in terms of the investment that they do with their savings, because the essence of economy is the investment and the savings that are with the people, because the more the investment, the more the economy grows. Of course, there are additional factors such as inflation that comes into play, but there is the government in the economy to make correction factors.
Also, standard tax deductions have been increased from 40,000 to 50,000, directly benefiting salaried persons.
So we can all agree on this point that this whole budget has been mainly focused on the people that are middle class,
backbone
of the economy, as well as the distressed classes like
farmers.
So this has been the main focus of this budget. So calling it a people's budget is very fair, and the statements that the Prime Minister has given, as well as the Interim Finance Minister has given, are fairly suggestive that this one is supposed to woo people.
Additionally, the banking sector of our economy that was a concern for most of the people across the country has also seen reinvigoration activities such as the NPAs, the issue of non-performing assets that were existing at this point. The insolvency and bankruptcy code that came out in 2016 has looked to recover more than 3 lakh crore in assets, and that's a big win for both the government and the banking sector of our economy. This goes to basically show that the people's money, the people who are depositing their money, has become more safer and safer by the day. And this is a development that not only the government should applaud, but the people as such, because it's our country, should applaud too.
Yeah, but this comes at the heels of major problems like the IL&FS issue that was recent, and apart from that, the couple bankruptcy scenes that happened last year, like the Nirav Modi and the other scams like Mallya scams. So this step is a step, but will it be implemented to the fullest, and whether it will address the gaping hole is a big question at the moment. So this is, yes, a good step and initiative, but is it enough is a big question that's going to loom over our budget.
As far as opportunities for youngsters are concerned, there is an ever concerning angel tax issue that has been at the apex of concerns for startups and youngsters who want to venture into their own businesses rather working for someone else and realizing their own dreams. Angel tax is something that has been a concern for these startups, because they do not want to give away most of their earnings or most of their savings in terms of taxation right before they start monetizing their own venture. And this is something that the government has to look at, because in the next years, when we are looking at giving power and giving fuel to the economy, I think entrepreneurship is something that drives the economy and drives the crux of the economy, which is the youngsters. Interestingly, speaking about the fact that more than 50% of India is under 25 at this point of time, there is a huge scope that we have in terms of taking over economies such as the People's Republic of China. And if we have to do that, there has to be a strategy to do that. Simply aggregating factors that might be strengths of the economy will not help us take over a $1 trillion economy such as the PRC.
Yes, another gaping hole considering youngsters would be the education level in the rural areas. This problem has been prevalent since many budgets now, and this one failed to address it again. There's low amount of training and resources available to the teachers and teaching faculties and organizations that are there in the rural areas, and this one is another thing that's not been addressed in the budget.
Also, healthcare has been not been addressed in the budget, which is a major concern.
healthcare. I think last year in terms of Ayushman Bharat was brought out to India. I think it's excessively benefited people from the lower segment of the economy. But I think work still has to be done on that part of the segment, because the more healthcare and affordable healthcare is accessible to the economy, the better it is for the economy. We have seen policies such as Obamacare in outside India, and we've seen that in the United States. Interestingly, there are debates about the viability of that particular policy, but that at the crux of it, we understand that it has benefited the crux of the economy. It has benefited the people who are looking for a more affordable healthcare when they are not able to get so. We've looked at the apathy of the government hospitals, and that is something that has to be alleviated. There are both sides of the spectrum where we have a government-supported hospital such as the AIIMS, but we have also the other hospitals that do not have basic medication facilities. That is something that has to be elevated in the years to come. I think if the present government wants to retain their holding of power in terms of the next 5 years, this is something that they have to work on, because more than 70% of India's population lives in the rural areas. And if they have to cater to them, if they have to cater to their development, they have to cater to their healthcare and their healthy development, because that is something that will sustain our country in the future, merely not loans and merely not economic incentives.
Another positive takeaway from this budget would be how they've promised to, maintain a good fiscal deficit. Like, they've told that they'll cap it at 3.4%, which is really good considering how much they're trying to give away this year for the election. So if they're able to compromise on a little bit of money, but not enough to make long-term problems, so that would be a good one. So even though they have given people away some rebates and some concessions and some gifts, I think it is to a fairly decent level, and it's very sustainable if they live up to their promises and not cross the caps they've set.
Nati, interestingly, as my friend mentioned, that the cap has been, fiscal deficit rate has been pegged at 3.4%. As per the Moody's report that came out just today morning, they've said that it's difficult to maintain this fiscal deficit at 3.4% given the reduction in revenues that the government will incur in the next year, and the increase in outflows that the government has proposed in terms of the Ayushman Bharat scheme and the other incentives that they have mentioned in the budget. The loom over debt that is going to be excessively given to the Indian people is something that has to be looked at, continuously monitored, and an effective reports of sorts have to be generated periodically. Because if the debt looms into something much bigger, I think we have seen worse problems such as the 2008 financial crisis, where the entire country goes into a financial collapse. I think debt should not be the catalyst of another collapse, which is prompted by people borrowing more and more and not having the capability to pay it back.
Also, another positive takeaway would be small businesses with up to 5 crore turnover, which are the 90% of the GST paying people in the country, would have to file returns quarterly, taking a weight out of their shoulders.
Adding on to it, just looking at the last term of BJP alone, the government, what has happened is, I in the last 70 years of independence, we haven't seen major reforms in the country's tax reforms or any sort of reform. But here we saw in Modi's term, we saw about demonetization, which was a major force. I would say it's a very debatable topic, but I would say it's a positive for the country in the long run. And we saw GST coming into play. Initially, when GST came into play, we saw a lot of people saying that it's bad, it's very difficult to handle. But now we see that it's so beneficial for the economy. And we see now it has been the highest indirect tax ever recovered from the economy, which has crossed a certain amount.
I think the GST that my friend mentioned about, is that it has reduced a very big problem for the country, which was the cascading of taxes which existed in the previous tax regimes. That being said, that is not only, even if there is something that has taken time to adapt, let's say GST was bought out long before where we are standing today, and if that has taken more than about almost 3 years now, 2016 to 2019, almost 3 years now, we have seen that we have more positive takeaways from this rebuilding and reconstruction process, because the entire country is phasing out to a new and entirely new tax regime, and the cascading of taxes that we spoke about builds a more positive image in the people, saying that yes, I'm paying tax for what I'm consuming, but I'm not paying additional tax that I'm not supposed to pay, which was the problem earlier. If we go back to the 90s, before liberalization, tax, personal tax in existed somewhere around 80 to 90%, where a lot of people, and which was the reason that a lot of people had a dissent in paying tax, which shouldn't be the orientation of the economy and the people. And that is a positive takeaway as far as I'm concerned.
Another also positive takeaway in the GST section would be the new directives they've given to the states. Like, they've made like a few limits, like 14%, and a few percentages they've set for the states to follow. Those have been very clear, because recently there were changes to GST that had become questionable, so they have fixed those to a very, very large extent with this budget, and they have given clear directives which have made the GST implementation back the belief it had from the people, which had gone away as soon as they heard the few changes that came recently to, you know, satisfy the state governments. But now it's back for the people, so it's a good thing.
Also, speaking about the positive things implemented in our country, I would like to talk about insolvency laws. Like, after scams like Vijay Mallya and Mehul Choksi, our government has really implemented the insolvency laws by implementing the NCLT, and now it's more dynamic process. And now it's more dynamic process, and a large amount of money has been recovered from bad loans by the banks.
I think interestingly, the Fugitive Economic Offenders Bill that was also brought out in coalescence with the Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code has helped not only recover more loans, but make sure that the people who are involved in this. I think the first Fugitive Economic Offender as termed for India was Vijay Mallya. And simply giving this term by definitive text of fugitive economic offender is someone who is defaulted on a loan of, or is owes the banks in the country or the financial entities of more than 100 crore in amount. So this is something that has helped reclassify people who are a deterrent to the positive growth of our economy, and recovering these bad loans and then reclassifying these people as additional deterrents will help us not only grow in economy, but also fight and in the sense defeat the people who have a detrimental thought or a detrimental effect on our economy.
Adding on to all of this, there's one positive takeaway that we are right now we are moving towards a more technological advancement terms of tax. Like, now we have online portals to file our tax, and it's way faster to get our refunds. That's a really good thing. But since our economy and since our government is now moving towards technological advancements, I see there's one thing that was not addressed in this budget, was something which is prevailing since the year 2014 and 17 especially, and those are the rise of digital currencies. And from digital currency, with the rise of blockchain and digital currencies, there's no clarity right now in the tax structure, and nothing, it's neither illegal nor legal, as I said. There should have been more clarity in how to file taxes for this, if there were any taxes. And also, in the last 9 months, there's no verdict from the Supreme Court. There's judgment pending, which was a case against RBI's versus the cryptocurrencies and digital currencies segment.
This consortium that my friend spoke about has been continuously pursuing to alleviate and integrate the people of our country into cryptocurrencies and digital currencies, because this is an asset class that is continuously growing across the world. And with the advent of blockchain, which is termed as one of the best inventions of the 21st century, it's imperative for our government to work on this, because this grey area and the sense of ambiguity that we have as of now in terms of whether it's illegal, legal, whether the government is looking forward, is not frowning upon looking for people who are, who are interested in trading these currencies. I think it's something that has to be clarified to the people. I think that's something that will also fuel the growth of this economy in the long term, and it's important for our country as one of the biggest democracy in the world, to help and to tell our people as to, look here, this is the fact. There's a clear distinction between what we want to what we want you to trade in and trade not in, because ambiguity does not help anyone, and as fast as that is cleared, the better it is for people. And the last point would be that it's very intriguing to know, and happy to know, that a chartered accountant presented this interim budget after almost 67 years of the Indian independence, 67 to 70 years of Indian independence. The budgets essentially were presented from people who are from not entirely from a finance background. This year's the presenter was a chartered accountant, and it does not only give the people a sense of ownership, it gives the people the understanding that policies are in the right hands when they're presented and when they're accepted by the people, for the people and of the people.
So my friends, we would like to discuss how we like the budget. Do we like it or not, starting from you?
Okay, absolutely. Like, in the whole run, thinking about the budget as a whole, it seems like a satisfactory budget for the middle class, because if you see the budget as a whole, it's being targeted mainly towards the middle class and providing the tax rebates and other benefits. But I honestly believe that they could put a little more emphasis also on education, because I believe the more our country develops in terms of education, we can develop the core factor in our country, the people, the human resource. The more we develop our country in this regard, we can prove superior to other countries. We can even raise our standards this way and prove to be a better country as a whole, because with a better human resource is a better country as a whole.
I really like this budget because it's targeted towards the middle class, which are the backbone of our economy, and it's helping, it's starting to help the farmers, it's starting to recognize the farmers finally, which were neglected before. Farmers were always neglected in our country, but now they're starting to take a vision of farmers. And basically, I like our government's stance of ease of doing business. Our governments are continuously working for ease of doing business, and our country is regularly improving in the ease of doing index, which is very good for our economy.
I think the budget on an overall basis helps the economy entirely, but there are crevices that are still yet to be filled, and one of these crevices would be, let's say, jobs. Jobs are not specifically addressed here. We have seen that the jobs have taken a real downturn since demonetization in 2016, and not much has been done about alleviating and elevating the people's standards and the labor standards when it comes to jobs. I think this is something that has to be increased, both from the government's perspective and in terms of public-private partnerships that would be helpful in terms of elevating the jobs, increasing the number of people that are, increasing number of organizations or increasing the number of jobs that are required, because there are technologies in the future that we have to adopt, and as long as we do not integrate human resource into developing these technologies, I think development will also be a far and a long distance goal, as I would like to call it.
According to me, the budget sounds good, but it's interim. So as they've put it, it looks like they're giving a lot away, they're not taking much from us, and there's a number of 3.4 they've put for the fiscal deficit, which is, I think, we should be very skeptical about it, because it's not a very easy thing to do. But it sounds good as far as it goes. The budget also was a budget that had quite a few U-turns from the policies that were already existing, or the policies that the government has been making. But all in all, it sounds like a good budget. It looks appealing, and I'm happy with it if whatever is written is the thing that happens.
According to me, the budget is a pro-people budget, which is actually beneficial for the economy, and I'm looking forward to the coming year and how things pan out, and especially the next budget, 2020 budget, and the complete budget of 2019-20. But there are two things I would like to point out here is, there was no emphasis on the minimum support price of the farmers, which should have given more emphasis on, instead of giving them a 6,000 monthly, yearly benefit into the bank accounts. That's one thing. And the second thing is, considering the fact that more than 1% of our population right now is invested or interested in digital currencies, there should have been more clarity on the tax reforms of these currencies.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.